You're listening to Vancouver Co-op Radio, CFRO 100.5 FM. We're here on the unceded traditional territory of the Salish, Musqueam, and Tsleil-Waututh Nations. This is Bernadine Fox, here with my co-host for the week, Glenn Gregg, bringing you Both Sides Now. Welcome to our show. I'm Bernadine Fox.
I'm Glenn Grigg.
And this is Both Sides Now. Unlike our neighbors to the south here in Canada, we experience homicides and suicides at a much lower rate. And while we can be proud of that, the lived experience of someone who has lost a loved one through homicide or suicide is no less traumatizing and no less bewildering. We're here today with John Dube, who is a registered social worker and clinical counselor and instructor. He oversees programs around suicide prevention and intervention, counseling, and education, just to name a few, because you do way more than that. Right. In his private practice, he works predominantly with those who've lost someone through homicide or suicide. John is here today to help us understand what folks deal with after losing someone in these ways. So, my first question is, what is the number one feeling people experience after the loss of someone through a homicide or suicide? Or are there two different topics? Are there two different feelings that happen?
There are different aspects of a loss by suicide and a loss by homicide. And so I approach individuals in a different, same but very different way. For homicide, many folks are always in a state of shock, but it's the experience of having the rug pulled out from underneath you, that the world is no longer safe, mm-hmm. no longer safe for you, no longer safe for those of your loved ones that are still alive. Lots of anguish around why did this happen? Mm-hmm. In suicide, there is more of the tragedy of not that individual not having reached out and sought out help or wanted to have a conversation. And so some families feel like they've been shut out from that individual who made that choice and who's died.
So when you say shut out, do you mean betrayed or pushed aside or rejected, or what does that mean, shut out?
It means that families want to know what's really going on with each other. Mm-hmm. And when somebody is feeling suicidal, they oftentimes begin to focus more internally.
Right.
And many of them don't have the energy or the capacity to reach out.
Right.
So as a family survivor, myself, I have had my nephew die by suicide.
I'm sorry.
It is very difficult to not sort of blame yourself in some ways, that you could have did something more, wish I would have been there more for that person. I wish I would have saw what was happening. Were there signs and symptoms that I miss? So there's a lot of questioning of yourself, of mm-hmm. the individual who's grieving. Mm-hmm. How did this happen without my knowing?
Right. Should have done more.
Should have reached out. Yeah.
Why didn't I make that call?
Yeah, totally.
Yeah. And so while you're talking, I'm thinking about the Bahamas and the images that I saw of entire, like, piles of houses on that you only know their houses because you can see a window or a door or a wall, and people probably feeling that way, like the entire rug has been pulled out. But it's not a homicide or a suicide because it's a force of nature, but at the same time, it's like your whole world has been turned upside down.
Totally. And with that type of loss, like in the Bermuda Triangles or when there's an earthquake, mm-hmm. the survivors respond by not their community is gone. So mm-hmm. their sense of reference is no longer there.
Right.
So the struggle in living is to recreate a community and recreate your village and recreate a sense of where you belong. When we have these huge devastations, it takes a long time for individuals and families to come back and mm-hmm. and regain a sense of the world could be or can be safe again. So that really permeates a lot of the work when you're working with people who've lost significant mm-hmm. Pieces of their lives.
Right? Yeah. Yeah, it's a very hard place to be.
Yeah, it is.
John, something I want to get you talking about is that when we've had devastating loss through suicide or suddenly somebody's gone from our lives because there's been a homicide, there seems to be two schools of advice that we get. One is get back to normal. And the other is, you know, the whole world has changed. And so you have to learn a new world. And can you help us navigate those two schools of advice? And what do you say about that?
You know, the common thing that people say, well, just get on with your life.
Yes.
Or, you know, seek closure and move on. My approach is not that way.
Okay.
My approach is relational.
Okay.
Even though the person has died, you still have a relationship with that person. The relationship is in your head. The relationship is in memories. The relationship is in feelings. You will always have that relationship with the person, even though they're no longer physically there. They're there in your heart. They're there in your memories. Mm-hmm. They're there in your brain. So I work with people to recognize that there are three burdens when there's a loss. The first burden is just the loss of the person that you love.
Okay.
Right? So yes. Homicide happens, that's the big loss.
Yeah.
Right? The second loss is you as the survivor, you as the bereaved, because you're no longer the same.
Yeah.
When a death by suicide or a death by homicide happens, it's like you've just been shoved into a totally different road or track. And so you have to refigure out how to put your feet forward. Where am I heading? What are my priorities? Who am I really in light of this tragedy? So that's the second burden, is that you are forever changed and you have to grieve who you are or who you were and rediscover who you are. Right? And the third burden, particularly around homicides and suicide, is teaching people how to be kind to you. So you're having to educate people around what your needs are, how you can be supported. You need to educate people around just to ask you questions, and it's okay. It's okay to name my loved one who died. And the third burden, I think, is probably one of the tougher ones, right?
John, I really want to pick up on that. One of the kinds of general advice that seems to be out in the world is, oh, there's been a terrible, tragic loss within the circle of my life. So when I go to work or when I go to my softball team or whatever, I'm not going to tell them because they're just going to talk about it and then I'm going to be bereaved. And can you tell us a bit about your thoughts about how do you let other people know that you've had a loss?
That's a good question. For me, when somebody hears the news that their loved one has died, we all go into a state of shock.
Yeah.
With a homicide and a suicide, and I'm not, you know, I include their tragic car accidents mm-hmm. or accidents, pedestrians being killed in the road, or any time that there's a traumatic loss.
It's sudden, it's violent.
You are in a state, you're traumatized, right?
Yes.
So we need to look at how you come back from that.
Okay.
And it's not easy. It takes a long time. It, you know, it's based on the relationship you have with the person who died. It's, and some relationships can be quite tumultuous, right? I forgot your question.
Well, you're dealing with that question so well, because where I wanted you to take us, and you absolutely did, was what are we going to do when we're in that state of trauma? Yes. What are we going to do when we're in that state of shock? Do we tell other people I've had this loss? Or do we just kind of tough it out and be stoic and get on with our lives? Or is there general advice that can be given?
I think the reason why I went down to sort of the trauma that we're traumatized, yes. One of the big things that happens is we lose all sense of boundaries.
Okay.
So we sometimes end up by telling our story to the person in the grocery store, or we're walking down the street and somebody says, "Oh, how are you doing?" And you tell them their entire story, yeah. Right? So the boundaries after a trauma are very porous. So people tend to tell their story over and over and over again. Yeah. And that's not necessarily a bad thing, but I like what Dr. Brené Brown has to say around vulnerability, around telling our stories.
Right.
That we need to tell our stories to people who are safe.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Okay.
So it's important that we take our grief and we carry that grief not alone. We have to carry it. We have to experience that ourselves. But we can carry that story together. Yes. And it's really important that you carry that story together with somebody you trust, somebody who you can feel vulnerable to, somebody who will not necessarily tell you what to do, but to just hear you, see you, and acknowledge you for the experience that you're undertaking.
We need to take a break, but stay tuned. We'll be right back.
Join us every Monday from 2:30 to 4 p.m. for She Boom. Open your ears to the sound of the latest and greatest women in music. Our show focuses entirely on female artists, from a local to global perspective. Every Monday from 2:30 to 4 p.m., tune in to She Boom on CFRO 100.5 FM Co-op Radio.
Starry, starry night, paint your palette blue and gray. Look out on a summer's day with eyes that know the darkness in my soul. Shadows on the hills, sketch the trees and the daffodils. Catch the breeze and the winter chills in colors on the snowy linen land. Now I understand what you tried to say to me, how you suffered for your sanity, and how you tried to set them free. They would not listen, they did not know how. Perhaps they'll listen now. Starry, starry night, flaming flowers that brightly blaze, swirling clouds in violet haze reflect in Vincent's eyes of china blue, colors changing hue. Morning fields of amber grain, weathered faces lined in pain, are soothed beneath the artist's loving hand. Now I understand what you tried to say to me, and how you suffered for your sanity, and how you tried to set them free. They would not listen, they did not know how. Perhaps they'll listen now, for they could not love you, but still your love was true. And when no hope was left in sight on that starry, starry night, You took your life as lovers often do. But I could have told you, Vincent, this world was never meant for one as beautiful as you. Starry, starry night, portraits hung in empty halls, frameless heads on nameless walls, with eyes that watch the world and can't forget, like the strangers that you've met. The ragged men in ragged clothes, a silver thorn, a bloody rose, lie crushed and broken on the virgin snow. Now I think I know what you tried to say to me, and how you suffered for your sanity, and how you tried to set them free. They would not listen, they're not listening still. Perhaps they never.
You're listening to Both Sides Now on Vancouver Co-op Radio, 100.5 FM. I'm Bernadine Fox.
And I'm Glenn Grigg.
And we're chatting here with John Dube, registered social worker and clinical counselor, about loss through homicide or suicide. John, one of the things you were talking about before we went to break was that about how it's important to talk to people. And one of the things that I recall you saying is that you never, ever do this grieving process alone. Can you talk a little bit more about that?
From my point of view, grief is a community experience. It's both a personal and a community experience. If we're looking at a homicide, oftentimes that gets splashed on the paper, mm-hmm. headlines. Same with a suicide, used to be quite prevalent where they would show right. that in the front lines or front page. There's two sides of the same coin. So some of the work that I do with people around a homicide death is for them to reclaim their own personal grief, right? In a homicide, oftentimes the police are involved in the grieving process, the court system, the investigation, Crown prosecutor, but the voice of the family is not there. The voice of the mm-hmm. individual who has died is not there. So the work is around bringing that grief back into the family ownership.
So I would think that it's exasperated as well, because the police and the courts and the prosecutor, they're talking about the victim and the body and the deceased and not your son or your husband or your loved one, right? It takes it farther away from that personal experience.
It's very depersonalizing. Right. And families oftentimes get lost in that shuffle that's going on. That is happening. And so some of the work is, how do you have the family give voice, their voice, mm-hmm. about the grief process, and reclaim that grief right. process? So there's that side of the coin. And then the other side of the coin is that there's tremendous healing in being not alone.
Yes.
In being in community,
right.
being involved in a village, that can't be underestimated, the power of people surrounding somebody or a family or individuals who are grieving.
And so just to kind of put a wrench in that,
okay.
just a little bit, what do you do with people who are loners, who maybe don't have a lot of extended family or don't have that community around them? How do you work with somebody to help them find people to not be alone with?
There, what I've discovered is great resiliency in mm-hmm. people, and many of them appear or think that they're alone, and they're not.
Right.
Nature is a great companion for mm-hmm. people. Okay. An animal is also a great companion for people to break isolation.
Yes.
God, the universe, what a higher power also can break that sense of isolation, right? Even doing things like music, listening to music or playing music or being creative, writing stories, playing the piano, guitar, that can also break a sense of isolation.
Mm-hmm. That's interesting.
Because that connects you to a bigger piece of life, right? So it's important for the people that I work with to look at their own sense of resiliency. How can they, many of them are feeling very tragic and feeling very fractured, right? And helping them come back around that, and it's okay to be fractured, it's okay to be disconnected with yourself, but it's important to slowly take those steps, bit by bit, slow by slow, right? And recreate your life in a way that you can walk down the street or be able to sleep at night or get up in the morning or do those kinds of things.
And how long does that take?
Lifetime.
A lifetime.
Lifetime.
Yeah.
I
suppose people don't want to hear that.
No.
No.
Like I tend to work mostly with parents who've lost children.
Yes.
Adult children or little people. And I remember this. And I have to be careful about sharing stories because many of the situations that I've worked with are fairly public or have been fairly public. But I do remember this this one mom that I was working with whose son died tragically. And when I first started working with her, I was very gentle around getting her to bring a picture of her child in and let's have a conversation as to who the child was, who he was, looked at his aspirations. And so we didn't necessarily focus on the incident where a lot of people get stuck on. We talked about the life and the qualities around him that she was holding. It took about 2 years of my working with her that all of a sudden she looked at me and she says, I want you to be really honest. And I said, I'll be honest. The sun will never be as bright as it used to be.
Yeah.
And I said, yeah. Well, how come you didn't tell me that, like when I first started coming and talking to you?
Yeah.
I said, because I don't know if anybody is ready to hear that so early when we're so raw, right? I have to be careful and sensitive around introducing the long-term effects of a loss.
Long-term as in lifelong.
Lifelong, yes. And it's not necessarily that I'm protecting individuals or families. I mean, they're very resilient people. So it's about being mindful. It's about sharing and coming alongside somebody who's had that significant death.
So you're walking along with them, not getting ahead of them.
No.
Yeah.
And not behind them.
And not behind them. That's your job.
That's
as
my
a therapist.
Job.
So, yeah.
John, I'm very pleased about some of the wisdom that I'm hearing coming from just talking about the time frame for grief. I often hear from people, you know, it's been weeks. How come I'm not okay again? He just said 2 years before even the idea that loss is incredibly painful. Can you talk a little bit about how we can give ourselves time when we've had huge losses?
You know, the biggest teachers in this work for me are the people I work with. They're the true educators to me around how to be present to people who've lost somebody. I've been very honored to hear many stories, mm-hmm. and the sense of resiliency and triumph, human triumph that goes on in our society today. I think that grief is a part of life. We cannot get away from it. And I think that our society is diminished when we don't acknowledge that we grieve. Yes. And I think that grief, as painful as it is, teaches us something.
Yeah.
And oftentimes it teaches us what's truly, truly important in life. And that's each other. And that's going back to community. Mm-hmm. That's going back to being part of a village, right? Priorities change all the time, mm-hmm. when I see a death, somebody who's died.
Yes.
But grief isn't the only feeling. There's all kinds of feelings that go into that, like anger and guilt and denial and...
horrendous emotions.
Angst. Yeah.
Horrendous emotions. Yeah. It's interesting because people sometimes ask me, how do I hear some of those stories? And I think what's most important is that I've learned to just be present. It's not my pain.
Mm-hmm.
It's not my story. But it's incredible to be able to be honored to hear that pain, to hear that anguish, yeah. that underlies their story, their narrative about what's going on in their life. And sometimes I leave my office and I'm a bit wobbly because of the energy that's been in the room. I'm very careful around that. I don't see people in a small room. It's always as mm-hmm. large as I can get to create as much space so that people can maneuver energetically. They might be sitting there, but the amount of energy the pain energy that can sit in a room needs a lot of space to be able to breathe and to move.
I used to work with survivors of severe childhood trauma, and I used to get that same thing. How could you do this? It must be so painful. It must be so horrific. And I felt like you in that it was an honor. And actually, I wasn't involved in their pain. I was involved in this very positive healing process.
That's right.
And that was kind of remarkable for me. I just felt it was remarkable.
People are remarkable.
Yeah.
Like, I get sort of emotional when I think of some of the people I've worked with, who still probably struggle today, and but who put one foot in front of the other and who continue to go to work, who have coffee in the morning, who make dinner, and
and those things can be hard. We need to take another small break, but it's a small one, so don't go away.
Everybody's walking on the city streets, got their hands in their pockets, their eyes in their feet. People all around, they don't wanna know. One foot then the other, just go, go, go. Don't look, don't talk, don't rock, don't say. Just mind your business, look the other way. I'm so tired of being afraid. Lift my head up and say, hey. Up to the sky, say thinking there's a better way. I'm just tired of being afraid. Lift my head up and say, hey, hey.
Safe in your home?
You are not alone.
Transition houses offer free support and shelter for women and children.
We are here for you.
We are here for you.
We are here for you.
Make the call.
1-800-VICTIM-LINK.
1-800-563-0808. bcsch.ca.
Food's been put away, a little soup left on the stove. I hear the last car leaving down the driveway and up the road. It was so sweet of Jim and Joan to make a trip so long. I guess now I'll be making friends with Gone. Flowers, they were beautiful, and everyone so kind. I thought how you'd have loved to see so many dear friends at one time. After all the stories and the toasts till nearly dawn, I guess now I'll be making friends with Gone. So glad we had those last days, laughing so hard at the jokes you made. And like every time that you drove away, you said I love you, and I called out I love you too.
Mm-hmm.
I don't wanna go to bed. Maybe just another walk down Cooper Road instead. If anybody asks you how I'm getting on, just tell them I'm still making friends with gone. Now forever making friends with gone.
You're listening to Both Sides Now on Vancouver Co-op Radio. I'm Bernadine Fox here with Glenn Grigg, chatting with John Dube about how suicide and homicide impact on those of us who survive it. I want to talk a little bit about suicide. We've been talking about homicide and deaths that where loved ones are yanked from us. And
that's right.
Suicide is a very different thing because somebody made a choice to leave your life and you're left behind. And so how does that, we talked a little bit about how that impacts on people. What's the long impact? What's the long-term consequence of that for folks?
You know, it's interesting because I've been particularly working in the area of suicide, suicide bereavement and intervention and stuff for many, many years. I'm afraid to say how many years.
It just means you're really smart.
No. It's not about, it's about hearing people's stories.
Yeah, but you learn from all of it.
Yeah,
that's what I mean.
I've learned. Yes. That's right. When it comes to suicide, I'm not sure, I'm in doubt as to if it's a real choice.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah. Because people choose to go to that edge of life and death because they want to know, to remind themselves that they're still breathing. That although the pain is extreme, it's like having your hand on a hot stove.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Huh. That's how much pain people are experiencing.
Yes.
So are they really choosing to die, or are they trying to get rid of the pain that they're experiencing?
So, yeah, so that's for me, sort of underlying the question that I had about choice. I mean,
Do we really have a? Do people who really have a choice? We know that some of the research done with jumpers from the Golden Gate Bridge in San Francisco, all the survivors changed their mind. Every single one of them changed their mind on the way down.
Mm-hmm.
Circumstances that has us believe that we're no good, or mm-hmm. that have us believe we have no choice, and so we move to a place of that edge of life and death because we don't know where else to go.
Right.
So for me, I try to work with families that are bereaved by suicide, that to look at that there's something bigger going on for their family, loved one, that there's things that we don't know, they don't know, nobody knows.
Mm-hmm.
And we don't fully understand the struggle that person was experiencing.
Right.
And I think for me to go there is to unhook families from guilt, from unhook them from the agony around why.
Mm-hmm.
Why did this happen, right?
And I just want to relate this back to a show we had on just a few weeks ago with a guy by the name of Jake, who talked about having been suicidal 5 times and actually trying seriously 1 time. And he said it wasn't about depression for him. It was about that he did not know how to continue his life because he'd run out of money and he'd run out of options and he didn't want to be a burden. And so that was his choice at that point. That's kind of ringing true in some ways.
Totally. Like, imagine your hand on a hot stove and somebody's trying to talk to you. Mm-hmm. You can't hear that person.
No.
Right? Because you're in pain and your focus is there.
Right.
And I think the family, even for myself and my own family, I've been working in that area for a long time, and to lose my nephew,
mm-hmm.
is extremely self-reflective as to what happened. Why did that occur?
Right.
And it's a very complex event that happened.
Mm-hmm.
So, and how do families come back from that? It takes time. It takes discovering for yourself the reasons why. For some family members, they do discover and are able to put the question why to rest, and other people can't, right? And so they have to hold that burden for the rest of their life, right? So
And guilt.
And
so
pain.
Is there a way to work with that guilt so you can move beyond it? Or are you left with that guilt as a family person or close person?
It's the story that I share with families is you get a pebble in a shoe.
Yes.
Right? Yeah. So you're walking in, there's always that pain, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then it becomes so numb that you don't feel it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And then you trip. And you stumble and you hit your foot in a different way and you feel that pebble. Pain is still there.
Mm-hmm.
Walking down an aisle and you look at their favorite cereal. You listen to somebody's favorite song. Mm-hmm. It's Sunday afternoon and they're not showing up for tea. All of those kinds of things are pebble in a shoe.
The things that
just
bring back
the pain.
Can
be just a slant of light or whatever's there. If I may, I want to take us into another set of emotions that I've been around at least twice. Groups of young people who lost, on one occasion, somebody to murder and someone to suicide. And it seemed to hit that whole community.
Yeah.
I could die. I could be next. And it was terrifying. Do you relate to that experience of people responding to the death of another and saying, wow, my death could be more imminent than I thought?
It's interesting. And the reason why it's interesting is because the younger you are, the more short-term that is.
Uh-huh.
Right? Because we tend to bounce back.
Yeah.
But I have worked with young people who've survived shootings in schools.
Yes.
And that has repercussions for their entire life.
Yeah.
Right? So for some, it ricochets for the rest of their life. And for some people, they can step over it and get back to sort of that illusion that life is infinite, right? I mean, we all do that. We get into the car, and we have total expectation to get to where we're going.
Yeah.
There's no expectation that we're going to get into a car accident and die on the way.
Right.
Right? So we all have that expectation that life will carry on.
Well, that's the miracle of our brain, right? That or else we wouldn't get out of bed in the morning.
That's totally right. So, that's totally right.
Yeah.
So... Death is hard. Death is not easy to approach. People discover things about themselves that help them come back from that tragedy or that event. People learn different priorities. Many people learn that what's most important is relationships, each other. Another very important thing people learn is to be more truthful.
Mm-hmm.
If I've had so many parents tell me regrets.
Mm-hmm.
I wish I would have said this. I wish I would have said that. I wish I would not have said that.
Mm-hmm.
So in a lot of the relationships I have, I want to be honest with people. I want to tell them I love them. I tell people that, you know, and hold on to those kinds of things. So many of my families have taught me how to be in the moment, how to appreciate each other.
Okay. One of the things that I think also is true is that some people, and I know this for myself, choose. My brother died at 19 and I was in my 20s. And I came out of that willing to take risks that I probably wouldn't have had I not experienced my brother dying at such a young age, because it kind of really does throw that whole illusion of life in the you know, somewhere else. So
totally.
The other thing I experienced in that is that we as a society don't deal with death. White people, I should say, don't deal with death. We kind of, my mother wouldn't talk about it. You know, it was just, you know, we had a funeral, but we're not going to talk about it. We're not going to deal with it. We're just going to go on. And I, growing up in that community, that was how I thought death was dealt with. When I went and lived on a reserve, I had a whole different experience of how you deal with death. They brought the body home, they put it in a casket, it was in their living room, they had three an entire days. Wake for three yeah. days. My experience of it was being taken there and being told I had to kiss this person, mm-hmm. which buckled my knees because I was suddenly up close and personal with death in a way that I had never been before. But I believe that that is actually a much more healthy way of dealing with death than what my community, but that's my judgment, so.
Yeah, well, I from my own experience, Western culture is not a good educator of what happens at the end of life, right?
So well said.
You know, and I've been honored to work on some of the reserves in Alberta mm-hmm. and have been
taught. I'm talking about Sutina, so you right. probably
and
know Sutina.
I was involved with the Piikani Reserve and the mm-hmm. Blood Reserve,
yes.
and they taught me the healing circles and have been invited to attend those, and the openness around talking about what that person meant to them. The tears that were shed, the mm-hmm. laughter that mm-hmm. was shared with them, the food.
Yes.
Like it's it's an event to acknowledge the life and the gift of that person to the community,
yeah.
right?
Yeah.
Because Western culture tends to be more individualistic, but my experience of the Indigenous community is community. It's about a village. It's about honoring each other and honoring our gifts for the community.
We need to stop here. But that was an incredible conversation. Thank you so much, John, for coming in and chatting with us about this. It was an important conversation to have, and I hope we all continue to have more conversations about death, even though that sounds a little weird. But I'm not somebody who thinks of death in that way. I've had an experience of being in a hospice with someone dying, and it was actually a very beautiful experience.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So
yeah.
It's not something necessarily to be afraid of. So thank you for coming in.
Thank you.
Vancouver Co-op Radio is a unique nonprofit radio station that produces creative and engaging programming for voices often ignored by mainstream media. We rely on the financial support of listeners like you to help us continue to produce innovative and hyper-local radio shows and podcasts. Please consider donating online at cooperadio.org/donate or by calling 604-684-8494. That's 604-684-8494. Thank you for supporting Vancouver Co-op Radio, your community radio and podcast station.
Oh. You're listening to Both Sides Now on Vancouver Co-op Radio 100.5 FM. I'm Bernadine Fox. Death awaits all of us. It comes to our lives slowly or quickly, gently or violently. It takes away people close to our lives and leaves gaping holes in our personal social fabric. How we cope with these deaths impacts our future. When we lose someone to a homicide or a suicide, we experience great shock, and the ensuing pain is particularly excruciating. The stigma is that much more present, and the guilt that much more encompassing. We are left with existential questions such as why, that may never be answered, and at times, especially with a homicide, a judicial system that impersonalizes what is a very personal and private experience. John was clear. If you have experienced a death by homicide or suicide, make this experience personal again to you. Don't do this healing process alone. Reach out and talk, even if you do that through activities like writing or art or just communing with nature. Know that you are forever changed by this death, and instead of fighting against what has changed, embrace and rediscover who you are now. Identify and develop a means of asking for what you need. Establish a narrative that will help you manage and incorporate this new reality into your life. And if you, as a listener, have had this experience or have feedback or questions about this topic, please do not hesitate to reach out to us here on Both Sides Now. An announcement. The Therapist Exploitation Link Line has published Telling It Like It Is, When Psychotherapists Abuse and Exploit. It's a collection of compelling first-person accounts written by victims of abuse by mental health practitioners, as well as information on the history of TEL, legal remedies, and prevention. I was honored to be asked to include a chapter for this groundbreaking book. It is available now, free for downloading or reading, at www.therapyabuse.org. And as always, this book will be listed on our resource page at www.BothSidesNowBC.com. So my thanks to Glenn Gregg for co-hosting with me today, and our guest, John Dube, for helping us understand the needs of those who've experienced these types of losses. Thanks also to Steve, who joined us today as our sound person. And our thanks to Sherry Ulrich and Don McLean for the gift of their music. As we have mentioned, we will be going live soon. Then you will be able to call in and join our conversations live. In the meantime, send us a tweet or an email, and we will share them with our audience. We look forward to hearing your voices.
Join nonprofit society Beyond the Conversation for Vancouver's second annual Walk to End Social Isolation on Saturday, September 21st. This inclusive multicultural event draws on the communities of Greater Vancouver in an effort to draw awareness to the devastating effects of social isolation in modern society. Participants will gather at the Plaza of Nations at 750 Pacific Boulevard at 9:30 a.m. At 10 a.m., participants will walk along the seawall toward Olympic Village Square by the Creekside Community Center. From 10:45 to 2 p.m., Beyond the Conversation will host speeches, group conversations, and other activities at Olympic Village Square. On Saturday, September 21st, join Beyond the Conversation for the second annual Walk to End Social Isolation.
If you have questions or feedback about this program or want to share your story or have something to say to us, we want to hear from you. You can reach us by email, bothsidesnow@coopradio.org, or via Twitter, @bothsidesnowbc. This is Bernadine Fox. We'll be back next week. Until then.
I can't seem to find my way under or over or through. Just when I'm ready. Such a cliche.